Hello everyone, my name is Victor Palarie. I am oral surgeon. Welcome to our webinar. I think most of you know me. I'm working in a private practice dedicated to patients with systemic diseases, especially. And this webinar is kindly supported by Alfa Gate company, and which is, they have very good products. And today we'll share, I'll share our experience in dental implants for geriatric persons. And I'll share a few experience of our clinic, and we are waiting for your questions during this webinar. And I hope in future hour we'll stay connected to us. So this is our center. It's a multidisciplinary center dedicated mostly for patients with diabetes and other metabolic diseases. We have the ophthalmology unit, we have the endocrinology unit, we have the cardiology, and every single patient is seen by all these specialists. And together we try to do our best job for our patients. So, let's start to talk about topic, and this is about age. Age is directly related not only to teeth loss, but also to anatomical, functional, and physiological consequences of edentulums and poor performances of removable prostheses. Okay, we have the patients of edentulous status elderly, they have some expectations. They want to have teeth, and but reality and possibilities today are limited to some aspects, especially this is for what age is our patient, what diseases does he have, and very, very important to know his psychological status, because the patient should understand very correctly that this teeth will need, these implants will need a special care, a special hygienic procedures, and it's very important also to explain him, or to, if she is a female, to her, that they will need to take a very strict hygienic procedures, and they will need to come to you, to your office for follow-up, because to repair problems such peri-implantitis is very difficult in such patients. Of course, for a lot of patients, this is not, how I say, third dentition, but it's also fourth dentition. Most of these patients, they know what does it mean to have an implant, and some of them, they lost already implants, and they have problems, already problems, inflammatory problems in their history. So that's why it's very crucial to select these patients before you start to treat them with dental implants. For example, this picture, you will see the a case where a patient had already implant placed more than 10 years ago. And now we need to remove everything because we have see have fractures, we have see infections. And of course, to restore again with dental implants, this site is a little bit difficult. And perhaps in such patients, it's more indicated to have a removable prosthesis than a fixed prosthesis on dental implants. Well, when we talk about elderly patients, it's very important to understand what does it mean old. Is it old still measured by a chronological age? What is associated between tooth loss and nutritional status? Lifestyle are very important to know economical status of this patient. Aging. And of course, it's very important to know the general health status of such patients. And for these questions, I'll try to answer today during our web seminar. In 1982 in Vienna, there was a World Assembly of Aging supported by UN, and they made a definition, what does it mean to be, what is old person? So up to 74 years, we have youngest old people. Between 74 we have middle old people, and aged over 85 years old, they're oldest old. So in all these categories, is very important to understand, do we, can we place implants today or not? There are a lot of studies where they show that until 74, it's, there are not too many contraindications to place implants. And after 75, the implants, this patient should be evaluated very critically. Perhaps they in general good health status, but we need to understand the psychiatric and psychological status, because there are studies where they show that these patients forget to clean their prosthesis, to clean their implants, and the end of such cases can be even a sepsis. And that's why it's very critical to teach again these patients and or perhaps relatives to take care about this dentition, especially when it's restored on dental implants. By this year, we expect to have we'll have a lot of patients, elderly patients. We'll have, of course, more men, more women than men. And in 30 years, 80% of all people will live in low and middle income countries. So all these aspects should be taken in account when we propose a treatment for dental implants for this patient, because today we see this coronavirus time, we understand that it's very important that older populations, especially dentistry, need to be integrated to the general health service. And perhaps in the future, we'll see that this dental implants treatment for old people will be also covered by an insurance system, which is very important. And because we see the problems, the nutritional problems of losing the teeth cause a lot of severe diseases. And today is really a good view to see that people with nutritional problems, they are more vulnerable to virus infection. What does it mean, an aging country? WHO definited if population is more than 8% of elderly people, then it's an aging country. Today, we have countries where the more than 30% of population, they're old. And we see today in this COVID situation that these countries are most vulnerable, like Italy, like Portugal, like Spain, like France, because they have a huge number of old people, and the general health system should be changed definitely, because to improve the quality of life and the quality of the service for these people for the future. And of course, this number will increase in time, and we expect to have more people in Japan, in Spain, in Portugal, in Korea, in China, Singapore, and Poland. So if we look at the prevalence from different countries, generally the talking statistics says that 40% of population, old population, they lost the teeth. And in some countries is less, in some countries more. And of course we see this increasing number of losing the teeth and full dentalism in poor, in low economical level countries. And definitely these countries will need to improve the quality, to keep the teeth or to restore the dentalus patients. WHO has a goal to retain at least 20 teeth at the age of 80 years of patient. This target concerning dentalism was reached in Sweden, Switzerland, Denmark, France, and Germany. But still, there are a lot of problems, especially in China and India and Africa, and we'll see this in the future, because the programs of WHO, they have a special programs for the dentistry in these countries, and I hope soon that they will improve, they implement also that. People in this country will have at least 2 implants, because to improve their nutrition and social life. Well, when you see a patient If edontologist in your practice, you need to understand that also they come of your to you of some medical conditions, and most of them they are arthritis, hypertension, heart disease, chronic sinusitis, diabetes, varicositis, hernia, hemorrhoids, and chronic bronchitis. And of course, you need to prepare your dental office for these patients. Of course, you need to be prepared that they can have complications during surgery. And of course, we try to avoid any sinus surgeries in such patients. And that's why one alternative, and I'll show you, is to avoiding sinus surgeries to use Olin 4, Olin 6 concept provided by Alfa Gate. Also, you need to remember that the cause of death in elderly people is mostly from the heart disease, malignant neoplasm, cerebral disease, chronic obstructive pneumonia problems, pneumonia, diabetes, and septicemia, another disease. So when you look and when you treat such patients, it's very good to have a general medical status, and that this patient should be consulted by a general practitioner, and you'll know full his medical history, because the complications, the rate of complications is still today high in the dental office for such patients, especially when they go for the oral surgery or implant procedures. Also, if you know the conditions, general medical condition, you'll know what medicine you need to prescribe, what antibiotics or what drugs for the pain and for the hygiene. And because I'll show you later that it's very important to know the drugs, what they get, because to don't have any allergic complications or allergic events during your treatment. So another very important topic when we talk about elderly is systemic conditions. These people, they don't have only chronic disease, but they have the systemic conditions, and they also they take some special drugs, and all these drugs can induce or can increase some complications. For example, if they have anticoagulant therapy, you're on the risk, increased bleeding risk. And these anticoagulants, they can take in different heart problems, maybe after chemotherapy, if they have problems of liver, renal diseases, they're vulnerable for microbial infections, especially if they are diabetic patients. If they have the arthritis, they are taking the corticosteroids, and also it can have it can induce you some complications after surgery. So this is very important, again, to know all the drugs, and it's not a verdict that you cannot do any implant in such patients, but you need carefully to evaluate such patients and to prescribe the drugs really which are needed, or to stop some drugs and to make a drug holiday. Again, this is a list of the drugs. There are a lot. I will not stop, but it's very important that in your record, the patient will write by themselves to relatives which drugs they take. And for example, like most of them, they have aspirin or non-steroid drugs, which are not very, you can work with these drugs, but other drugs like antihistamines or anticoagulants, you need to know and to record these drugs prior to your implant surgery. So, okay, we go now back to our dental implants, and this is a sentence formulated by Brannemark: no one should die of their teeth in a glass. It's really, could say, a fantastic sentence, but it's not realistic always. A little bit from the history, Brannemark placed his first implant in 1965 for a patient called Gösta Larsson in Göteborg, Sweden. He had the problems of cleft palate, and he got implants for the full mouth rehabilitation, also for the ear prosthesis, and he died in 2006 of these implants. So these implants were fully functional and they were functional for more than 40 years. And yes, these implants can work more than 40 years. But again, if the patient is very careful evaluating and if the patient come to you for a regular follow-up. This schema is very important to know for us to know, especially in the elderly patients, because we know the phenomenon of osseointegration, and we know all these parts like phases, like from hemostasis, from inflammatory, proliferative, early stage, late stage remodeling, which has again two stages. But in elderly patients, this schema, these phases, could be faster, could be slower, or can have some impairments at some of these stages. For example, here you see the histology of Alfa Gate implants, and very clear you can see that for the surface of these implants, you can see the newborn, which is more blue, and the lighter blue is the older bone. And you see that the bone how attack the surface of the dental implant. And this special situation, I will need a special implant with a special surface which will induce for me the bone, because this balance in bone of bone remodeling of the elderly patients could be disturbed. So that's why the surface of the implant should be osteoinductive. And of course, for me, one of the surface which will induct the bone, everybody knows, is calcium phosphate. And the last week, Dr. Panjali already told about this surface. I won't stop to that, but I will show you in a few slides how does it work. So, for example, we have some condition. What we will talk today is osteoporosis. And the osteoporosis, we know that it reduces bone density. Autoimmune disease, so we have non-complete bone healing, cardiovascular bleeding diseases, and diabetes. So these four systemic diseases are mostly seen in the dental practice, and especially in elderly population, and perhaps you see these patients in daily basis, and perhaps you have some questions how to deal with such cases. The ideal case when we have a lot of bone, we have in volume and in width. And of course, when we have such patients with these two roots, we can use these roots for anchorage as a natural implant. And the easiest way is to make for him a classical dental prosthesis according to Gerber procedures, and the patients will be very happy at the end. But not always the bone conditions intramouth can accept this dental prosthesis or can patients can keep them. Or if the bone conditions are good, there are other psychological problems like vomiting, which are fully indicated for dental implants. But before talking about dental implants in such cases, I'll go to remind you some basic principles in dental implantology. And success and failure does not only depend on your expertise and skill, but also in particular on qualification of your team. And you need to teach your team how to work with you, because they should, if you have an assistant, normally you should have two assistants, and which they will prepare for you the surgical theater, and also they will take care preoperatively for and postoperative for your patients. Also, the success and failure depends about sterile procedures and patient disinfection. And today we see that sterility and disinfection is very important, especially when we have virus infection. And I'm quite sure, but after this pandemic situation, we'll have a lot of changes in, especially in sterility disinfection, and there will be more severe rules. Because especially for dentists, as you know, dentists are most vulnerable specialty from medicine to any transmission of the virus infection. from patient to doctor or from doctor to patient. So sterile working step by step is very mandatory at all steps, including surgery, including post-surgery, including prosthetic evaluation, and so on. Implant general rule, we need to have minimum 7-8 millimeters vertical bone and minimum 4-6 millimeter horizontal bone. The bone sets the tone. And in elderly patients, everybody knows that we want to avoid any major bone augmentation. So that's why we look today how to use the native bone or amount the bone or to preserve the bone, because for our future implants, or if you don't have necessary bone, to avoid any major complications. So what is the difference between the teeth and implants? First of all, the implant is a dead titanium surface. We don't have any periodontal space. And we have minodeterminant stem cells, if only our cells. But this definition is good only for the poor titanium surface. When we have a calcium phosphate surface, we have a large amount of the stem cells of near this surface, and we'll have this bone implant ankylosis much, much stronger than to a normal SLA or machine surface titanium. Of course, the benefit of the teeth, everybody knows it is much, much better than any dental implant. It's because it's a vital tissue, it's not a foreign body. We have a periodontal space and we have a lot of cells from PDL and from alveolar bone. And here is a schematic, what we see here in these histological slides, that the teeth are more resistant than in implants, and this one should be taken into account when we restore these implants of dental prosthesis of delta crowns. So talking about surface, why calcium phosphate? First of all, it's hydrophilic. What does it mean? It means that it attracts the fluids even when you touch them. So here is again our histology, very nice histology slide, where you see the newborn and old bone on the dental implant surface. And here you can see this touching only the fluid, that this fluid is spreading on the old surface of the dental implant. And in this clinical picture is very well seen that how the blood is going up to the surface of this dental implant. And as somebody mentioned in the literature, the blood loves calcium phosphate surface. And by the way, our group was the first who proved that on the calcium phosphate surface, the bone is growing, and it's growing on the vertical dimension. So this is our publication, and which was a pilot study where the implants were placed supracrestal. So they were just covered by periosteum. And we have seen after 3 months that the bone was growing on top of the implants, and there was a real new bone. So this is here, you can see on this slide, how the bone is really nice growing on the vertical surface of the implant. And this is a graphic comparison of conventional SLA implants. And you can see, definitely can see that amount of the bone implant, percentage of bone to implant contact is twice as much higher than to a regular titanium SLA dental implants. Also, we conducted a study in patients where we replaced 124 implants with major and minor augmentation procedure, and we got a success rate of 99.7%, which is really high percent. We lost just only one implant in this study in a smoker patient, and in the rest of the patients, we also included here the elderly patients and diabetic patients. So 99.7 implants were fully osteointegrated, and they still today they are working very good in mouth of the patients. A very important tool for our dental implants and for your practice is to know to have knowledge and to measure implant stability. As you know, we have primary stability and secondary stability. Primary stability is due to macro design of the dental implant, and the secondary stability is due to the integration of this implant to the human body. And of course, a very important point, which induces, as I said before, is calcium phosphate. So in your daily practice, mostly you can see primary stability, and this primary stability you can see during surgery. You can see the quality of the bone, and this is you will see when you are doing drilling. When do you insert implant, this is for that you will use the dynamometric ratchet, or you can use other devices which are more scientifically, but in some of the countries, they most of the doctors, they have it because they document all the cases and they record this data for the stability in case of any legal problems. Normally, we and Alpha Gate, according to our studies, we recommend to have a primary stability, adequate primary stability. This is meaning from 35 to 45 Newton centimeter. Of course, you can get a lower stability, but depends which protocol do you follow up. And of course, you can get a higher stability, but when you have more than 45 Newton centimeter, you have a chance to have ischemia of the bone and you have supercompression of during insertion to the implant. And then, of course, the resorption of the bone. So for us, is the best is to have 35, 45 Newton centimeters. This Dr. Zahalka did a very nice study using an Ostel device, which measures implant stability during all healing phases. So they placed more than 100 implants, and they measured this stability in time. They placed healing abutment, and every week they took out the healing abutment and they did these measurements. So the primary stability, they got a lot of good, very good primary stability around 68 ICQ, which is around 40, 45 Newton centimeters. Of course, at the second week, due to inflammatory phases, the stability is going down, but not too much. It's going to 64, which meaning around 25 Newton centimeters, and then slowly going up. And at the week 8, at 2 months, they got a really very good secondary biological stability, which was much higher than primary stability. So it meaning the conclusion of this study is that after 2 months, you can definitely load these implants. Well, this is was a really study on healthy patients, but how does it work in non-healthy patients? Because not all of our patients are healthy. Some of them they are smokers. Some of them they are with other medical problems. So we recommend to wait 4 months for the mandible and 6 months for the maxilla for such patients. I talk about medically compromised patients, but there are other cases, and they'll talk a little bit later, other diseases which you need to wait even more. So a classical case, edentulous, when you use two implants in interforaminal area, in our education team of Alpha Gate, we start to teach our young doctors of these patients because they are easier for them to learn, because as you know, in anterior mandible we have more bone. It's really, the quality of the bone is really nice, and they can follow all the steps very easy and safe in order to perform such surgeries. So this is here a classical case. We conduct according to the Gerber and Condor principles. We see all the movements of the patient, of the future prosthesis in all plans, and of course, today we induce. We think it's much better to have the CAD/CAM bars for such implants, to split these implants together, and then to have the suprastructure also from metal and also on CAD/CAM system, because the stability and passivity of these prosthesis for this construction is much, much better, and patients can clean it much, much better. So we don't have losing of the abutment and so on. And this is a classical prosthesis, and a happy patient which can chew and speak and talk. This is a teacher, and I want to tell you a story, because every year Alfa Gate company has a very nice project to implants for teachers, and usually in October they have this program when they donate implants, and we place for free these implants for the teacher, especially because a lot of big teachers, they continue to work after retirement, so they need teeth and they need to talk. And this concept, when we use two implants and CAD-CAM reconstruction of the prosthesis on these two implants, is really very good. And they, and these people, they can work and can talk and eat and so on. So how do we teach them? Normally it's one by one. Every student is going to see this. First of all, we have preclinical training. So they learn how to use the drills, constructivity, which type of the speed, what type of the torque. Of course, we teach them about the primary stability, and of course, for the beginning, we advise for everybody to use a dynamometric ratchet to document the primary stability of your dental implants, the final primary stability, and how, as I told you before, recommendation is up to 45 Newton centimeter. And for me, which I think is one of the best system, is impression, including click transfers. This is the innovation of AlphaGate. You don't need a huge transfers for very expensive. This is not so expensive. And the precision of this impression is very, very high. And here you'll see how we do. First of all, we're doing one-step impression. We make the impression around the transfer. We need to have a lot of material, of course, of the silicon around this on the lingual and the vestibular aspect. It should be a very it's normally a heavy material, and then they take it out, and as you can see, the precision of this is very good, and the stability of this transfer is very high, and it's very easy also to place analogs. Recommendation according analogs is that doctor should place analogs into transfers, because then if you leave it for the technician, you can have problems when they put these analogs, and maybe you will have problems with your prosthesis. Also, disinfection of these analogs is mandatory, and the better is if you have the single-use analogs. But if you don't have these single-use analogs, you need to disinfect and sterilize after each patient these analogs, because for the hygienic reason. Here you can see the analogs are very tight, and this is how we place. And this is done by the doctor immediately after the impression, and then impression is disinfected and goes to laboratory. Of course, for such case, you cannot use click transfer. And in this case, we use the conventional transfer for the open tray. And mostly that we use when the implants are placed in angulation or special transfers for the all and four, all and six concept. But let's go to our, to our medicated persons, and we will talk here about anticoagulants. Mostly today, most of the patients, they have warfarin or coumadin. This anticoagulant change INR, it's called international normalized ratio, is time of prothrombin. So in this patient, they are very well controlled, because they every week, they make blood analysis and to see that this prothrombin time. And this warfarin is compensated by insurance company. The second generation is dabigatran or pradaxan. It's more expensive drug and it doesn't make any changes in prothrombin time. And in some countries it's covered by insurance, in some countries it's not covered by insurance. So this is mostly you will see patients with warfarin, but since 2 years ago, Pradaxa comes a lot to the market. And that's why when you ask patients for anticoagulant, you need to ask him which drug does he take and does he make every week blood analysis, blood test. So normally these patients of anticoagulants, we send them not to general practitioner, but to cardiologists for consultation. So they have the schema how to stop or have to have drug holiday before your oral surgery or dental implant procedures. You can place these implants in such patients, not a contraindication. Normally these drugs are prescribed for patients of arrhythmia, and normally this patient is stable. Our protocol, we change 3 days before surgery, we change anticoagulants of fraxiparin, subcutaneous twice a day, 24 hours non-anticoagulant diet per day, 24 hours anticoagulant diet. So, and the Coumadin or Pradaxa, they start the next day of surgery. But there is a high risk in patients with heart valve prosthesis, high hypertension, and if it's associated with diabetes. So such patients, I recommend to refer to the hospital or that they will be, because here, perhaps you will need assistance from general anesthesia if you don't have your dental office. So let's go. Drug support surgery. We have local anesthesia of epinephrine. And generally, if needed, is diphenhydramine and fentanyl for the pain and to calm the patient after surgery, Tranexan to make it slower the bleeding after surgery. But if it's needed, and normally in such patients, we have a support from our colleagues from anesthesiology. And of course, if you have such patients, it's very good to have a monitor where you can see the the heart rhythm and to see the saturation of oxygen. One case, a patient of anticoagulants, of arrhythmia, he came to us after, and this implant were placed 10 years ago, and he came to us to remove these implants. In such patients, I don't advise to use any autogenous bone grafts, just to use synthetic bone grafts, and you can use alpha bone from Alfa Gate. And I recommend to use also PRF because, as you know, PRF also have the ability to stop bleeding. So anticoagulation therapy, you can stop, you change it, and then you use for augmentation of such procedures, you use synthetic bone material, including PRF. The next is again, it's a lady, she had this implant for 25 years and she had a fracture of this implant. We decided to remove this implant and why not to place implant. Of course, the space to the nerve is not too high, and we decided to use short implants and a little bit we placed oblique to avoid the nerve. And as you see, can see here, they're fully integrated. And of course, we didn't use any autogenous bone for augmentation in such case, only synthetic material from alpha bone. But one of our mistakes, what we saw, we stopped. They had the bleeding after the second day when we removed the stitches. So it's very important. And we for all our patients, especially elderly patients, we use only resorbable sutures. We don't use any more non-resorbable sutures because even taking out of the stitches can result to bleeding after 2 days. So in such patients, use only resorbable sutures with antibacterial surface. Diabetes, mostly of the patients what you see in your practice is diabetes of type 2 non-insulin dependent, and all the literature say that in this patient is safety to place implants or to perform other oral procedures. But what about type 1 insulin dependent diabetes? And in elderly patients, it's going not so good because it induces a lot of complications, eye complications, they induce the xerostomia, induce the food problems, renal problems. So it's a little bit controversial. Can we place implants in such patients or not? But I'll try to share our knowledge in this situation. So as you know, diabetes is a pandemic of our century, and we expect in this year that 20% of population of the globe will have a diabetes, and in 30 years I think we'll have 40% of diabetes on the globe. Why? Because I think it's very useful. You can see on this slide, the Coke is much cheaper than a bottle of water. This is from American shop. What measurements do you have to know which type of diabetes or which level of diabetes? First of all, it's glycated hemoglobin, then it's bone densitometry, and then you see the vascular neurologic status. Last two are more important for practitioner, for general practitioner, especially on the foot surgery and eye surgeons. For us, it's most important glycated hemoglobin, which is mean blood glucose in 3 months. And of course, you need to ask the patient if you don't have any complications, like example from the fingers of the foot, because if he has something like that, if he'll tell you, I cannot properly walk, and you see if his diabetes properly walk, maybe you refer him for general surgeons, and you, because to see his fingers. In such cases, you cannot touch the patient for any dental procedures. And what are pre and intraoperative consideration? Metabolic control should be analyzed and optimized prior to implant surgery if not sufficient. Glycosylated hemoglobin level near 7 mg/% is advisable. So between 6 to 9, we can place dental implants. And if a patient is on type 1 insulin dependent, and if he has this number between 6 and 9, you can place for him dental implants. But there is one point: every single diabetic patient, please see them in the first part of the day, in the morning. Never see them afternoon because of the complications, because they need to eat, they need to have properly eat, and they need to monitorize glucose. And in the morning is mostly more optimal glucose level in the blood for such patient. And of course, the post-operative considerations are shorten recall intervals and to detect any intraoral infection disease and to see if they don't have xerostomia. Because if they have xerostomia, you need to prescribe them artificial saliva. The next step is critical bone quality pathologic conditions. And here is my former chief and my scientific advisor from Germany, Professor Alna Vass, who is the chairman of oral and maxillofacial surgery department in Mainz. And they have a really nice center, and they have a really, they are specialized for patients of immunosuppression, radiation therapy, bisphosphonates, and antiogenic therapy. And of course, they treat this patient and they rehabilitate this patient of dental implants. So this is, I will share our knowledge from Germany, from Mainz, regarding this patient. So osteoporosis. We have a primary osteoporosis, which is in a postmenopausal woman, age-related, and idiopathic. And we have a secondary osteoporosis in more than 25 systemic or drug-induced disease. For example, we can have osteoporosis after diabetes, we have in alcoholism, we have in after heparin, after anticoagulant treatment, after anticonvulsant treatment, and a lot of systemic disease. So osteoporosis is very crucial, it's very difficult to treat. And we see more and more people of osteoporosis because, and first of all, is due to our lifestyle and low vitamin D, and we are not moving. So we will expect more patients of osteoporosis in future. What are considerations? So we need to know the which is the cause of the bone disease. We need to avoid any bone augmentation. And post-operative consideration, if the patient is a candidate for us, we need to prescribe him a dose to increase the dose of vitamin D and calcium during post-operative period. And the healing period should be increased at least of 2 months. So from 4 months to 6 months in the mandible, and from 6 months to 8 months to maxilla. And of course, we need to be very careful in his prosthetic treatment to don't have any occlusal overload or bruxism. And you need to be very careful which type of material will you use. Definitely, I think this is zirconia and these fancy materials are very expensive, and they are not for such patients. Everybody of you know about bisphosphonates and the inhibitor of osteoclasts, and they are prescribed in severe osteoporosis and Paget disease, in tumors of metastasis to bone, myeloma, and malignant hypercalcemia. And they have a very low intestinal absorption. At the beginning, they are prescribed orally, and then if the disease is going more severe, they are prescribed intravenously. The use of systemically administered bisphosphonate, especially intravenous, of course, they will help patients of this disease, but they can induce a very strong and a very bad complications like bisphosphonates related osteonecrosis of the jaw or osteochondronecrosis. It was described first in 2003 by Marx in the state, and then is going more in Europe, and also described also after ear surgery in 2006. So bronch is defined as exposed necrotic bone appearing in the jaws of the patient, treated by systemic intravenous bisphosphonates, never irradiated, and has persisted for more than 8 weeks. This is, for the beginning, it was a questionable disease. Does it have correlation between dental treatment, oral surgery procedures of penis or not? So if a patient will start to go bisphosphonates treatment, it's very important that before this treatment, the whole dental treatment will be finished in his mouth. Because if you start a dental treatment after that, you can have problems. And for example, some slides about these defects of the bone defects, when you need to not only to extract the teeth, but also sometimes you need to go deep and to resect the bone until you'll stop the progression of this necrosis. Another case, like it intraoral view of the bone necrosis, and extraoral, you'll have the fistula and you'll have the abscess, submandibular abscess, and in such cases, this patient will go for major resective procedures, including to cut the mandible and to restore it then after that of a titanium plate. So implant placement in patients with intravenous bisphosphonate should be postponed and contraindicated. Patient taking oral bisphosphonate for up to 3 years, generally it's not a contraindication, but you need to have a really good evaluation of the status of these patients. According to some guides, especially from the United States, if the patient is on oral bisphosphonate, it's not indicated to have any major bone augmentation like sinus lift or bone regeneration, GBR. And there is still today, there is no a schema how to work when the patient is going with oral bisphosphonates. Some clinics, they advocate to have a drug holiday at least 3 or 6 months before implant surgery, but there are not strong, there are still today, there are not strong evidences about such indications. Another case, what we have seen in our clinic is a patient with lupus erythematosus. We have seen 6 patients, all of them, they are female. We placed implants and we didn't lose any implant in such patients. But there are some tricks how to treat this patient. Normally, they are not contraindicated for oral surgery and implant surgery. You need just to follow some rules and I will show you. So this is our first case. Patient was referred to us from other clinic. She got implants. Removed all the teeth. We don't know why they removed the teeth. Normally we try to keep this teeth and to save this teeth, but she removed all the teeth and she had post-extraction implant insertion. And you see here on the X-ray that implants from the maxilla were placed very deep and more than 3 millimeters into the bone. So once she come to us in this situation, imagine, the option implants are fully in the bone, more than 3 millimeters. Rest of the bone is destroyed. No prosthesis, nothing. So what can we do? And the lower implants, we have a really big bone resorption. And the question was, do we need to extract these implants from the maxilla, from the mandible, or we need to keep them and to follow up and to try to do something from them? So we did started to do cleaning of dental implants. We didn't do any bone plastic surgery for this peri-implantitis, just cleaning. And the patient came to us and we every three weeks for the cleaning of these implants in the mandible for professional cleaning. And then she learned how to clean at home properly. For the upper implants, we removed bone just only on the top of implants and we ordered from the Alfa Gate company special abutments for all and four multi-unit for this case, because normally, you know, they don't have this long, they didn't have at those time this long abutments, and we ordered from them. So this was our special multi-units, and we used here a multi-unit concept. But as you see, totally, because she said, I don't want to have any removable prosthesis in the mouth. And this was one of our, let's say, mistake at the beginning, because we said, okay, we do the screw retained prosthesis for these 4 implants. But you see the cantilever, it's more than 3 teeth. So this was okay for 3 years. And you see the X-ray, she come after 3 years. It's quite stable. Everything is quite stable. Even the lower implants, after cleaning, we have some bone opposition. But in lupus patients, one of the signs is that they have changes in all articulation, and they started to have changes in TMG and also the facial muscles. So she came to us that she cannot eat anymore. She has pain in the articulation. And she feels that she needs longer teeth. And we propose her to change completely the prosthetic org. So we came to the idea to have the bar instead of the screw retained, and prosthesis should be retained on the bar and for better hygienic and the reason, and also that we will be able to make the teeth longer every year, because now every year we change her teeth to make it longer because of the problems of the jaw. And here is the picture of the face. It's a special, the typical picture of the lupus of the face. You see the muscle, atrophy of the muscle, and the long teeth, because she feels more comfortable with this teeth because of the pain in the and the TMG. Another patient where we placed, we see here a huge bone resorption. We placed 4 implants in the maxilla, and again we used the same concept. We start with screw-retained, and then we change for the prosthesis retained on the bar on these 4 implants. Always doing the changing teeth to do it longer and longer. And the typical face butterfly of the face of this patient. When we talk about all and four, I think you saw a lot of videos, but the reality is not so easy, because if the patient had a long history of the removable prosthesis in his life, he'll have a very weak, soft tissue, keratinized, and it's difficult, and we will have the problems when you elevate the flap. So you need here to be very careful with your aspirator when you elevate the flap, because it's very easy to destroy the soft tissue in this case. And this one we see in the patients, not only who had for a long time prosthesis in their mouth, but also in patients who had teeth extraction in the past, at traumatic teeth extraction without any bone augmentation, without any sutures of the flap. So here is typically a case when you need to be very careful when you cut the soft tissue and when you elevate, and you want to elevate mucoperiosteum on flap. Because as you say, you need to have a special respirator and also to cut this of the forceps. So this is how it's going. Also, you can see here a lot of remanences of the bone after teeth extraction, improper healing, but we need this bone to place here implants. So of course, we will not cut this bone, because we will need to place implants in this area. This case was one of our first cases of Alpha Gate using full rehabilitation of the mouth with dental implants. In those times, we didn't have any guide for the placing implants, so everything was based on the radiography and the skills of the surgeon. So here, the surgery was done by two surgeons. I was myself and Dr. Aran Zahalka from Israel. And he's one of the inventors of this technique, and we used only according to skills, our surgical skills, and how to see the X-ray picture in the surgery field. Here you see the first drilling. This is and in the maxilla is very important, because here we have a more sponge bone. We don't go with the high speed. We always go with the slow speed, around 400-600 RPM per rotation per minute, and also irrigation, and we go forward and back the drills, because if you go only forward, you have the risk to destroy the bone. So the second drill is 2.8, and we go even slower. And I want to show you something here, and this why we go slow and this step down and back, because here we have can collect a lot of bone, and this bone we always keep in the special place, and if you need it, we augment the small defects, or we mix it of calcium phosphate synthetic bone for the further augmentation. So this is a small trick. Always go slowly and do this forward and back, and because to collect the bone. And of this special dress, you can collect really a lot of bone. When we place implant and when we use a ratchet, it's very important to use both hands, and with this finger you always push implant inside, because if you use only this rotation, you will cut only the bone, but you will not push the implant inside. So in this way, when you push the implant with one finger, you also condense the bone, and the bone started to be enlarged, the bone, and you don't have the risk that the buccal plate will be fractured. So the more forces the surgeon is putting on direction inside the implant than on the foration of the ratchet. So this is really crucial, especially when you work in the maxilla, because as you know, in maxilla, we have a really soft bone, especially in posterior maxilla. Anterior maxilla, we have a little bit harder bone. It's around D2, D3. But you need to be very careful, because in anterior area to avoid the nasopalatal artery and nerve. And you can see here very good. It's here is the nerve. Of the first drill, we go just the cortical, and then we have the same sequences of drills for the future for our future implants. So this is a max implant from Alfa Gate. It's indicated especially for the soft bone in the maxilla. It has excellent primary stability even in very soft bone. And with this implant, when you have a really really D4 soft bone, you can get 25-30 newton centimeters. So, and this is more superior to the conventional implants because it's self-dealing, self-taping. So the implants, and again, the insertion and implant here, in this case, we'll use a screwdriver from Alfa Gate. I love this instrument. It's very easy to work with this instrument because in the maxilla, you have more forces pushing inside the implant, also the enlarging the bone than of the ratchet. So it's much, much faster. So I advise you, strongly advise to have this screwdriver when you place your implants. And the next is the last implant is also we place it under 35 degrees. This is a calcium phosphate implant, and you see the blood, how it's going to the surface, very nice. And also we use a screwdriver because, as I mentioned before, you can see here how it enlarged the bone and increasing primary stability, and it's much faster than the conventional ratchet. In this case, we had a really soft bone, but because we used here proper implants of self-taping, self-drilling, we could increase the primary stability to 30 newtons. And we decided that we can go for the immediate loading of acrylic teeth. And here in this case, we remove the bone which we don't need. And we'll go to place the healing abutments. Normally, in most of the cases, we use 2-3 millimeters height of the healing abutments. And then we'll use the impression, conventional impression, and then we'll send it for the laboratory that for delivery of the provisional acrylic dentures for these implants. In these implants, we use a force for 25 newton centimeters for the multi-units. After that, we close the wound of sutures, of resorbable suture, always, because we don't want to take it out after that and it would resorb, and we want to avoid any hemorrhage after removing of the suture. So we placed in the transfer for the multi units, and then we split them together with the floss. And after that, we also split them the floss with polymerizable material to have these transfers will not move in our during our impression. So this is the final suture, And this is the view of the sutures. And now we apply our material, rubber dam, for the, and we polymerize it. And then the, it, everything will be stabilized together and for impression of open tray. So this is a view of, and then you can see it's very hard, it's very good material. And then we use the impression. We remove the screws for the transfers and remove the impression from the mouth of the patient. Again, the using of screwdriver in such cases is much, much easier than to use a normal screwdriver or a ratchet because you decrease the risk of losing of the screws in the mouth of the in the mouth of the patient. So this is very tight inside the screwdriver, and it's very easy to take out the then to take out the tray from the mouth. So this is the final view after impression, and we will send the impression for the laboratory work. The next case is column 4 in the mandible. In the mandible, we have really nice bone. We have really good quality of the bone, but we need to be careful in the of the presence of the intermental foramen and the mental nerve. So that's why we need to have really good elevation of the flap and to see the nerve and of this instrument of one respirator, because we have here two instruments for the to opening the flap, and one instrument always should be placed to cover the nerve in order to protect it during the drilling. Again, we use the steps when we go forward and back of drills. In this case, we don't destroy the bone, but we collect as much bone as we can for the, perhaps you'll need it for the augmentation. As you see here, it's very dense bone, and always we don't go straight to the bone, but always we go in this moving to don't destroy the bone and to collect as much bone on the drills during drillings. So this is the view of our future implants. Here we place the implants. Unfortunately, we cannot use a screwdriver in the mandible, so that's why we'll use the surgical ratchet. And it's a little bit difficult to sometimes to place in the back because of the tongue, and that's why it's very important to have a really good training and clinical trainings, because that's why Alfa Gate provides such trainings. But for the final documentation of the insertion, we always use a dynamometric ratchet, and we'll show you that we use always 45 newtons, because in order to don't have overstress to the bone. And here nicely you can see here the 45 newtons, at the 45 we stop, and the implants are really placed perfect into the bone. Another view of the final insertion torque, and you see here you have a click of the dynamometric ratchet and it stopped. The next steps, and you here see a very nice view of the stop, and in this case we stop here the 45 newtons insertion of our dental implants. Another view is, you see, it's very sometimes it's very hard to go on anterior mandible, but as I told you, remember to don't have overloads in this area, because the risk of the fracture of the bone is very high. So again, it's we stop at 45 newtons to insert the dental implants. We place here the again the multi-units, and this case all multi-units we have here 2-3 millimeters in the height, and the insertion of the multi-unit is 25 newton centimeters of the screw. And of course, the suture of the resorbable suture, because to, as I told you, to avoid any complication, then to don't remove the prosthesis after suture. We used in this case the old procedures of patient. It was rebuilt in the lab, and it was inserted in the same day in the mouth of the patient. I'll not stop about the prosthetic procedure of this case, because we'll have another webinars about all in 4 and all in 6 concept, and our colleagues will talk more about this concept. We screw it, and we ask the patient to have to keep it for 4 months, and after 4 months we change it for the final prosthesis. So this is X-ray after surgery, and this is X-ray after 5 years of the final prosthesis. I want to tell you that the patient didn't come never for the follow-up. He is a diabetic, and always I was calling him. He said, "I'm fine, I don't need to come." He came just after 5 years when he had the fracture of one tooth. So everything is good. We have some bone resorption, but now the question is, perhaps we will change this fixed restoration to a removal restoration to the bar, because only for the hygienic reason. So the concept is really very well, very good. But what about the periodontitis, patients with inflammatory processes, when you need to save some teeth and to place some implants? A case when definitely this teeth you need to take out, but in order to place future implants, we will need to augment this bone. So here we see the defect of the bone, the panoramic and the CT picture of the defect. And here we see an intraoral defect extraction. We use augmentation of alpha bone, membrane, suture. And here we used also, because to keep tight the EPTF sutures, which you need to remove it, but we used the antibacterial coated vicryl resorbable suture, which is not removed. And here is a temporary view after 1 week. And patient came to us after 4 months for the implant rehabilitation. We still have some bone defects, but as I told you, in such patients we want to avoid any major bone augmentation, so we decided we'll do the surgeries implant placement without any major bone augmentation of the vestibular defect. So here is preoperative view. We use here a guide, a conventional guide. It's not so bad bone, only aesthetically we could augment it in buckle place, but due to the age of the patient and the comorbidities, we went only for the implant placement. So implant placement using the conventional guide. As you see here, we have the lot of bone on the drill, and this bone will keep it because to little bit to augment the bone. And here we see the implant placement. Of course, the implants are not stick parallel, but taking in account that she is on anticoagulants and the aesthetical result is not so important, we need here more functional. So we decided to keep this implant for any major augmentation procedure and with prosthetic conventional prosthetic treatment after 8 months. Another case when we have the fracture on the central incisor, and the patient is on anticoagulants, he's a smoker. So normally we had the plan, or we redo the whole prosthetic work with a cantilever, or we place an implant. So we decided to go for the immediate implant placement after tooth extraction. So this is the view. We did the impression before surgery, remove the crown, extraction, very, very traumatic extraction. So, and we kept in place the buccal bone, which is very important. If you don't have the buccal bone, then you can forget about any implant placement in such patients. Because as I told you, avoid any major bone procedures. So we place the implant, the direction of the implant is more palatal without touching the buccal plate. And here you see the implant in place. It's a bioactive implant, calcium phosphate. And for the gaps between implant and bone, we'll use the calcium phosphate synthetic bone from Alpha Bone. And we'll use the temporary abutment for our future work. We use it immediately in the impression of composite material for the crowns. We place it in place, and then we the conventional glue of the crown to the abutment, the placing back, and this is the final view of the temporary crown of this patient for 4 months. Then we'll go for the conventional metalloceramic crown. Another case is about post-extraction in elderly patients. This is a regular patient without any disease. We did extraction. We got here 40 newton centimeters of the primary stability of implants. In the same day, we did of click transfer, we did impression, sent it to the lab, and in 3 days we got the final the abutment and acrylic crowns. We placed it, but of course you need to keep in mind that we need this crowns should not be loaded, so the info occlusion. Another case of severe periodontitis in elderly patients. So patient come to us after 2 months of extraction in the mandible, in the left mandible. We placed 2 implants in post-extraction site. And after 6 months, we loaded them, and then we started to go for anterior mandible. We did teeth extraction, so and we decided to place 2 implants immediately. 2 implants, of course, of inclination, lingual inclination, of our touching the buccal plate. This is a view of 1 week we let it to heal it, and this is a compress on the wound to protect the wound from the any food. And this is a temporary bridge on two teeth and 2 implants. And after 6 months, we'll proceed with final rehabilitation. So this is a view after 1 week. And we wait until the soft tissue will also be healed around these acrylic crowns. With this slide, I would like to thank you. And if you have any questions, let me see if you have any questions. Let me see any questions. No. And this way, I would like to thank you and to see you in our next. To see you in our next webinars. We'll have a lot of webinars with a lot of speakers from all around the world. And hope in this pandemic time, you'll have time to join us and for sharing our knowledges. Thank you very much.